Now I'd like to welcome Linda Goldstein to the stage. She's going to go over the federal regulation shakeups in regarding to the native advertising world that I think we're all, you know, living in and working in. And there's some important new regulations in place that she's going to take us through. So I'd love to welcome Linda to the stage.
Thank you, and good morning, everyone. What a way to put a downer on what has been really an amazing event than to bring a lawyer up here talking about how the government wants to regulate all the creative ways you're thinking about to overcome the advertising challenges that we're facing. So let me also start. You're going to hear me say some things that are going to sound pretty crazy. These are not my opinions. I'm only reporting what's happening out there just to kind of give you an idea of how crazy things are getting with the Federal Trade Commission. So let me start first by how many of you in the room do know what native advertising is? We've been talking about it all the last 2 days. One of the things that struck me is there is actually a lot of debate, I think, in the industry about what encompasses native advertising. We'll start with one of our resident experts, and then I'll tell you what the FTC thinks, if we can go to the first video. That is not playing. Sound? Nope. All right, well, anyway, there seems to be almost more debate today than when this first started about what native advertising is. Does it include branded content? Is it just content where, and sorry, where you're embedded in a native format? The official definition that's sort of come out is basically there are two elements to it, that it's in a native format, meaning it's seamlessly integrated with the content around it, and it matches, and in functionality, the consumer would essentially interact with the content the same way they would with the other editorial content within which it's embedded. What's the problem with it? I'm not going to try to go there again. John Oliver had some humorous things to say about what is native content, what's the problem with it. But essentially, from the Federal Trade Commission's point of view, the problem is that you're blurring the lines between advertising and editorial content so that essentially the consumer can't tell the difference. And you might ask, so what difference does it make if the consumer can or cannot tell the difference? How are they really being damaged? This just kind of goes back to really decades of FTC principles about transparency. You may recall they regulated the infomercial world. They regulated advertorials and required that that there be disclosure on those that that's advertising rather than editorial content. And essentially, their concern is that they believe consumers have a right to know if what they're reading has somehow been paid for by an advertiser. And that can actually happen irrespective of how heavily the content is even promoting a particular product or service. And their concerns are not, I guess I would say, not unfounded. There was a national survey done by an independent researcher just looking at a couple of different types of native ads, and I think the results are kind of interesting in terms of what we found here and where the FTC ultimately ended up. So this first one was a paid post. It appeared on the New York Times site. You can see the little Chevron logo there, and the disclosure was paid post right above the article, which was really about energy needs. Only 71% of consumers that read this identified it as an article, which means less than 30% actually knew it was an ad. This was another one that appeared on the Wall Street Journal, and here you had the disclosure was sponsor-generated content. There was a little icon that led to a pop-up that explained that this was paid for by Mercedes-Benz. What's striking to me is the article talks about the 2015 C-Class sedan. Nonetheless, 80% identified this as an article and less than 20% identified it as advertising. Another one for BuzzFeed. Again, you can see the Miracle-Gro name, logo. It's all around, but it was an article about ways to improve your gardening this spring. 71% identified it as an article, less than 30% knew it was an ad. The only one that did well in this survey was this content that was sponsored by Loco. And again, you don't have much more disclaimer. It's got presented by at the top, but you do have the product immediately to the left of the article, and somehow that made a difference. And 29%, only 29% identified this as an article. So over 70% actually understood that this was an ad. But this kind of survey, this survey actually preceded the FTC's guidelines. The FTC was looking at this issue for well over a year and a half. And literally on Christmas Eve, they came out with their native advertising guidance. And I will tell you that it really caught the industry by surprise. The industry was somewhat blindsided, particularly among the publishers. There was very little discussion with the publishing community about what these guidelines said. And so what I'd like to do is just give you a flavor for where the FTC is on this. So there are really three key points to these guidelines. The first one is transparency, and it's just the general principle that they believe it is misleading if consumers cannot differentiate editorial from commercial content. If it's an ad and an advertiser paid for it, then they think that needs to be disclosed. And if the disclosure is necessary, it has to be clear and conspicuous. And here's where the FTC kind of went to town, and I'll talk about that in a moment. And the disclosures have to be made before the consumer gets to the native ad. So for example, if you're going from, you know, some of the widget, the recommended for you, or you know, around the web, it's not enough if the consumer clicks on that thumbnail and then gets to a native ad. They have to know before they click on that thumbnail that they're going to be directed to an ad, because the FTC thinks it's incredibly harmful to a consumer to take the time to click on something that they think is content only to find out that it's an ad. So even just in the 2 months since these guidelines have come out, the challenges for brands have really been enormous in four ways. When is the disclosure required? Where does it have to be? What does it have to say? And who's responsible for the disclosure? So in terms of when it's required, the FTC, in its infinite wisdom, basically said, unless it looks like an ad, you have to disclose that it's an ad. They did not provide a lot of guidance on how you really know whether it looks like an ad. Some of the things they said were, how similar is the format to other non-advertising content on the page? The more it looks like the editorial content, the less likely it is to that consumers will understand that it's an ad. You know, how is it distinguished from the advertising content around it? One of the examples they gave was a native ad for, this was a fictitious company called Wing Mercury, which was a sneaker company, and they said, suppose they put a native ad on a publication called Fitness Life. Take the same content. In one story, there was a headline, Run with Mercury, run. Then it talked a lot about running. And then within the article, it said, if you want more information on Wing Mercury, click here. In that example, and I can't show it to you because the FTC provided no visuals, they just kind of made this up. In that scenario, they said, you know what? Consumers would probably know it's an ad because you're basically telling them, go here for more information about Wing Mercury, so they could probably discern that that was an ad. On the other hand, if you simply had the same article in Fitness Life paid for by Wing Mercury, but you just talked about running, and even if you talked about, you know, if you talked about the kinds of performance of different types of shoes, but you didn't mention them specifically by name, consumers probably wouldn't know it's an ad, and therefore there would have to be a disclosure. This is one situation where the distinction that I know is made in the industry between sponsored and branded content may be relevant. For example, here's one that was run by American Express for Open Forum. Their logo is all around it. You can tell, I mean, they're clearly talking about certain features of their services, and even though it has the look of a native ad, the content is such, and there's enough branding there, and this sits on their site rather than on a publisher's site, that consumers would likely know that this is an ad. The other thing I just want to mention is if the content says nothing about the product. Now, I don't mean it doesn't mention the product, but it's not product specific at all. It's about, you know, 10 great places to go on vacation or 10 great places to run in the park. That also would probably not be considered an ad. Now, the fact that it's been paid for, the FTC would want some disclosure of that, but you wouldn't have to use the term advertisement, which, as we'll see later, is one of the most favorite terms the FTC has recommended. So where do the disclosures have to be made? This is where the industry was really blindsided because the FTC got very, very prescriptive. If you have insomnia some night and you want to read the guides, I guarantee you it'll do the job. But as you read through them, it's sort of like la, 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 la. The FTC talks very generally about you have to be transparent, truth in advertising. And I have to be honest, I was reading it Christmas Eve and I'm like, this really isn't so bad. Then you get to the last page and it's like, bam, because they get so specific in what they want that they've really taken a lot of the creativity or the ability of publishers and advertisers to sort of control the messaging away from them. So some of the things they said were, it's got to be in close proximity, meaning in front or above the headline of a native ad, very, very specific. If it's a native ad that's sitting on a publisher's site, then it's got to be on the main page of the publisher's site and on the click or tap into page that of the native ad itself. They went so far as to say consumers read from left to right. So if you've got a box, the disclosure should be on the left side rather than on the right side. If you've got those, you know, around the web recommended to you and you've got multiple tiles in there, some of which are sponsored content, some of which are not, you actually need to make clear exactly which ones are sponsored and which ones aren't. This is an important one, that the disclosures have to be made in a way where if the ad is retweeted or syndicated or republished in some way, that the disclosure will actually follow the native ad. And again, that it always has to be made before the consumer receives the ad message. There is a lot in the guides harping on this, that they don't want what they call deceptive door openers, meaning you lure the consumer to that page without letting them know before they got to that page that what they're seeing is a paid-for ad. They're also very prescriptive about how the disclosures have to be made. So some things we would expect, prominent type, size, font, clear, plain language, but this is where they really stunned the industry because they went further than that to say these are words you can and cannot use. So the no's are things like promoted or promoted stories, which is a very common terminology being used today. And another no is presented by, promoted by, brought to you by, unless the advertiser only paid for the content. So I'm referring again to what I said earlier. If it's paid for content, but it is not promoting the product or service, so it's not technically an ad, you don't have to use the word ad, but you do have to use these words to disclose the fact that an advertiser has paid for the content. If it's an ad, meaning you are actually in some way promoting a product or service, then you've got to use the terms ad, advertisement, paid advertisement, or you can use sponsored advertising content. Now, this is not to say there aren't other words you could come up with. I would say these are the safe harbors. If you use this terminology, you're going to be fine. If you use something else, then we have to do our job and convince the FTC that whatever words you're choosing probably mean the same thing. And we've had some of those conversations already, and I don't want to leave you with the impression that there's no flexibility here. Who's responsible? Pretty much everyone in the native advertising ecosystem. One of the things we've seen, I mean, I've seen a lot of things in the last 10 years with this commission, which is the most aggressive commission I've seen since I've been practicing. But one of the things that distinguishes them is the very wide net of liability that they cast. So they will often, where they think there's a violation, they will often go after everyone in the chain that participated in some way. What can happen? The FTC can come after you. This is not a situation where there would likely be any kind of monetary fines or penalties. The FTC actually doesn't have the authority to issue fines. They can demand restitution. This isn't a situation where consumers are buying a product that doesn't work. So we're not likely to see these cases be money cases, but they may require you to enter into a consent order, which would say, in the future, you will always disclose the fact that native advertising has been paid for by an advertiser, et cetera. And the problem with these orders is that they live forever. In some cases, they might expire after 20 years, but that's the minimum period of time. Once you sign an order, you're forever on the FTC's radar screen. And for the agencies out there, it's really not good in a client pitch to have to disclose the fact that, oh, by the way, we're under an FTC consent order, and periodically the FTC comes in and they ask to see, you know, kind of what we're doing to make sure we're on the up and up. And of course, from a marketer side, it can cause, you know, brand damage to brand image and reputation, because it just will impact the credibility that consumers may have with you in the future. I do want to mention some other potential risks. One is, because native ads are ads, like all advertising, if there are any claims about the products or services in the ad, they're subject to the same rules as traditional advertising, meaning the claims have to be substantiated. And the FTC went so far in the guides to say that if an advertiser takes an article that actually was independently written about its products or services and then pays for a sponsored link to link to that article, the advertiser has now adopted that story as their own, and they're responsible for any content or product claims that might be contained in that argument. I want to mention the interplay of testimonials and endorsements. I didn't have enough time today to touch on influencer marketing as much as in addition to native advertising, but particularly in light of the earlier presentation this morning, the whole area of influencer marketing is probably even more active in terms of FTC scrutiny right now than native advertising. Like the native advertising guidelines, the FTC has guidelines on testimonials and endorsements that apply to influencer marketing. And they basically, it's basically the same principle, that if an influencer has been paid by an advertiser, the advertiser has an obligation to ensure that the influencer always discloses that connection or the fact that they've been paid. We handled a case that just came down a few months ago involving Machinima, which was one of the multi-channel networks that did an influencer campaign for Microsoft. Many of the influencers did not disclose on their videos that they had been paid by Machinima. The FTC didn't go after the influencers. They went after our client, Machinima, and they said, you, Machinima, as the agency, you had the responsibility to make sure those 15,000 videos that were uploaded on your network all contained the right disclaimers. And there's a real connection or interplay, I believe, between native and social influencer campaigns, because actually the influencers are often the ones that are in or curating some of that native advertising. And so you then have to consider not only how are you going to disclose the fact that this may be paid content, but how are you going to also disclose that the person that is appearing in that content has been paid by you as well. So you need to consider that as well. And then finally, I just want to mention third-party rights. Nobody would do a television commercial and feature an athlete without getting their permission. You would never do that, because you know you can't use a celebrity or a person's name or likeness in advertising without their consent. Well, the same thing applies to native advertising. If native advertising is advertising, as the FTC has now said, that means you can't just pull from, you know, and use celebrities or other third-party copyrighted materials or things in that ad. They would also be subject to the same rules as your traditional advertising. So I hope I haven't scared you too much. The good news I want to say is that after the FTC issued its testimonial and endorsement guides, the industry kind of got a one-year free pass where the FTC brought a bunch of cases. They didn't take any formal action. They just kept using those cases to send warnings to the industry about what they mean before they brought their first case against Sony and its advertising agency, Deutsch, which, both of whom did have to sign a consent decree based on an influencer campaign that did not disclose the material connections. So I think we have at least a year to play around with this, but keep abreast of the FTC website. The cases will be coming. They'll probably be closed informally, but they'll probably give us a lot of guidance in the next year. So thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you, Linda. So everyone get out there and create some content. Let's get it out there.